I'm Lee Brown, Head of Ozone at the Grosvenor Group. I'm also Managing Director of Interactive Fleet Management, the Grosvenor Group's fleet management business.
I'm Steph Clark, Account Manager, and I help our customers move to a low emission future, as well as many other things, of course.
We launched Ozone in 2017 to help companies make the smooth transition to ultra-low emission vehicle fleets. It was quite a visionary step back then. Not everyone was ready for the electric vehicle conversation, if I'm honest. But 3 years on, we've won several awards, and we're now seen as real pioneers of green solutions.
Ozone is basically broken down into three key elements: the financial implications of choosing alternative fuels, the operational ones, and the environmental, of course. If we take Glenmorangie Whisky, for example, they have a real passion for sustainability, but being in the Scottish Highlands, the move to electric technology was challenging. We mapped out the availability of charging points in the key locations their drivers travelled and the number of garages that could service electric vehicles too. As a result, they now have plug-in hybrid models of the four-wheel drive Mitsubishi Outlander alongside the fully electric Nissan Leaf. We also ran an EV roadshow for the staff, which was a great success.
At Tata Steel, sustainability is at the very heart of what they do, and a key objective was to drive down their emissions. With our support, hybrid, plug-in hybrid and electric vehicles make up more than 20% of the Tata fleet. Their total annual carbon emissions have reduced by more than 12%, and their average CO2 has reduced by 11%, and this is improving year on year.
For Weetabix, we ran a video workshop with their drivers during lockdown. From this, their new ultra-low emission policy was launched with improved choice and low emissions. We encourage the use of OLEV cars as it provides a far better reflection of the true financial picture of alternative fuels, and Weetabix really embrace this.
We're now helping many businesses drive down their emissions very strategically. It's not just a case of adding electric vehicles onto your choice list, and the structure of our support is delivering results for fleets large and small.
Hello, my name is Darren Handley. I'm the Head of Infrastructure Grants at OLEV. I'm going to be talking today about our plan for zero emission fleets and what we're doing in OLEV. For those who haven't come across the Office for Low Emission Vehicles before, we're a joint team between the Department for Transport and FAES. As you can see, we cover quite a lot within the team, from infrastructure, energy, the communications around low emission vehicles, about messaging to the public. We look at electric vehicles and hydrogen. And we're also responsible for the incentives that are there to try and get people to move to those technologies, research development, and helping local delivery as well as national. So we cover a lot. So why is all this important? As you see for some quotes from our Prime Minister earlier this year has really seen as a turning point, hopefully, in the drive towards zero emission vehicles, tackling global warming and setting us on a way to the ambitious 2050 goal of net zero. So within this, we consulted with everybody. Hopefully you had the chance to reply to this earlier on the date for ending the sale of new petrol and diesel cars. This consultation has finished, but the results haven't been published yet. And we did look to include hybrids in the question for the first time. So for those who didn't see the consultation, these are the sort of things we're asking about. Phase out date for internal combustion engine vehicles, exactly how it should be done and what should be done, the barriers, so for obviously as fleet managers, it's important for you guys and girls, the impacts that these may have, and what government may need to do to actually achieve an earlier phase out date. So hopefully the outcome of this consultation will be published this year, and you'll be able to see its findings. So what drove us to it? Excuse the pun. As you're probably aware, transport is a major emitter of greenhouse gases. In fact, the largest by sector. with cars and vans, being up there pretty high on their own, not just the transport sector. So actions needed to really reduce these if we are going to tackle our commitment to greenhouse gases. So in terms of the grand plan and timescales, there's a number of things that are going on to help the uptake of low emission, zero emission vehicles. On the supply and demand, the EU legislation on fleet emissions is really helping with the supply of electric vehicles as manufacturers need to reduce the overall carbon emissions from their fleets. In government, in OLEV, we are looking at the incentives to actually encourage the demand and for people to purchase electric vehicles. We're predicting somewhere in this decade there will be cross parity between electric vehicles and internal combustion engine vehicles, and after that the electric vehicles will be cheaper. And this will help drive the uptake of those vehicles. So where are we now? Well, this year is actually transformational. We've seen a rocketing number of ultra-low emission vehicles registered this year. So far up 175% compared to last year. And the number of vehicles and models available to buy is also similarly increasing potentially. I think now just about all major players have at least one electric vehicle, and there's so many more coming in all shapes and sizes, which is great news. Where particularly are areas for action in government? As I said, we want to reduce emissions, driving the uptake of cleanest technologies. We recognise HGVs and road freight has their own challenges within this. And another key challenge is the provision of infrastructure to enable that transition away from fossil fuels. And then supporting UK industry to be at the forefront of this, academia, and working, as I said, at a local and national level whilst doing this. So how are we increasing the uptake of ultra-low emissions? We have the incentives. So these are plug-in grants and tax measures, which I'll talk about in the next slide. Winning hearts and minds, getting the messaging out there and challenging preconceptions which are not correct about electric vehicles. Interestingly, you should start to see green numbers out there, so people can identify and self-identify that their vehicle is electric, which for many models is not that easy to tell the difference. So this is an interesting development, and we'll see how it goes. We have the government fleet initiative, where the government is committed to changing its own fleet to electric, which is ongoing work. And then working with dealerships as well, making sure the messaging given to the people buying cars is coherent and as accurate as it should be and needs to be. So vehicle incentives, what's there to help you buy a vehicle? We have plug-in grants. These currently, as you see, will run to 2022-23. We have a spending review going on, so hopefully this will be extended for a bit, but until we have that announcement, we can't say more. There are a range of grants available, up to 20,000 for large vans and trucks. Within this, there is some capital, for example, for vehicles, I think it's £50,000 is the most expensive vehicle that you can buy on our scheme. This is all there to provide best value for money for the taxpayer. Apologise for the bottom line, it's loads of acronyms there. So what do they all mean? CCT is company car tax. So this is the relief of company car tax and to extend it to 2025, which is, again, a key driver we're seeing for the uptake in electric vehicles. The vehicle excise duty, VED, or car tax, as most people still refer to it, has the exemptions for zero emission vehicles there. So all of this actually helps make it cheaper to buy an electric vehicle, which is the aim of the incentive. The other side of the coin is the infrastructure. It's no good having electric vehicles if you can't charge it. So to help with the grid, we have our smart requirements, which we continue to look at. We continue to see what we can do within the building regulations to make new homes actually have electric vehicle charge points. And then we have our schemes to help build up that infrastructure and making sure that they work for the people using them. And the EV Energy Task Force is where we talk to industry to make sure we're working together in a coherent fashion. So the infrastructure schemes, this is kind of the area which I head off. So we have grants for installing charge points at home and workplaces. The workplace charge schemes is there for charge points for staff use or for depots. So for fleet managers, this is available. It's for up to 40 sockets. Depending on your charge point, you may have one or two or even more sockets there. So this is per socket. We also have an on-street residential scheme, which is provides monies to local councils and authorities to install charge points where they can't be put in homes or businesses. So well worth lobbying your local authority for them to apply to the scheme if they haven't done so already. Then recognising that actually industry needs to have a commercial incentive to deliver infrastructure and can come up with novel ways of doing so. We have match funding for the rollout through our Charge Point Infrastructure Investment Fund. Yeah, been doing great deals. So all of these have really started to push on with the provision of charge points in urban and suburban areas and for helping for those journeys to and from work. What about the larger journeys? This is where our work on strategic road network comes in, of trying to make sure there's rapid charges for those quick stops for long journeys. And as you can see in the slide, we have ambitious plans for the number of high-powered rapid charge points across England. It's worth noting that our plans only go far as England because the strategic road network in the rest of the UK is devolved to the other three administrations. And within OLEV, this is where Project Rapid comes in, which is a £500 million fund to support that ambition. What the fund is doing is working out what the actual rather than perceived need for rapid chargers are, and where it's not commercially viable to put them in, actually provide that support and help to get them in. It's quite complicated, as you can imagine, to put them in. There's a lot of planning and there's a lot of costs. So it will be, it is an interesting project that will take some time, but will really help develop and deliver that rapid charging network that the UK needs. So I've talked now about what we're doing for the infrastructure and vehicles. This is a little bit on the research, give you an idea of what we're helping do. So we're looking at the power. Wireless charging is something we've provided funding on to see how it could be done and the challenges around it. Vehicle to grid is again another future initiative that is important to look into and fund. The Faraday challenge is looking at batteries, and you see we're also funding research into hydrogen. technologies. Before I end this talk, I'd like to just talk a little bit about the consumer experience as well. So we've got a consultation ongoing to really make the use of EV charge points as good as it should be. So four key areas we're looking at: payments, to make it easy to actually pay, particularly for public charge points, and so that you don't need that multitude of apps. It's really difficult to go from Model A to Model B to charge your vehicle. Reliability of those charge points is one of the key bugbears when someone turns up and the charge point's not working. So we need that to be addressed. The information, where is it available? Again, where can you charge? What's occupied, what's not? And within that, pricing information so that people understand how much it's going to cost. And actually, even how the prices are quoted are consistent. So there's quite a lot of action going on here to improve the consumer experience of having an EV charger. So that's pretty much a whistle-stop tour for what we're doing and how it may affect you as fleet managers. And I hope that's been interesting for you, and I'm happy to take questions now. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Virtual Fleet and Mobility Live and the first presentation in this three-day event. I'm your chairman, Jeremy Bennett. I've got to be quite strict. We have just a few minutes before the next presentation starts, so I've got to be strict on the amount of time we have. But if you wish to continue discussions beyond this time, then there is a networking lounge, and you can access that by going via the networking link in the event website. Now, we're very fortunate to have Dr. Handley with us today and Lee Brown from the sponsor, who can answer questions live over the next few minutes. And I can see already that, thank you very much, attendees have submitted them already, so I will start. Dr. Handley, if I pose the first one to you, and Lee, please feel free to contribute as well where you think you can offer some guidance and advice. So first question is, based on your presentation, Dr. Handley, when you predict the price parity in your presentation, did that include government grants?
So the honest answer is I don't know the answer quite whether we did factor in government grants. It's quite a tricky calculation looking at price parity, and so there's quite a margin of error. So it definitely will be this decade, exactly which side of 2025 and how you measure it is open to debate, I think.
Okay. Another question submitted by our audience, highly critical one. How is the government going to balance tax revenues with the loss of income from fossil fuels, especially now with the considerable and growing burden of coronavirus debt?
So I think this is a higher level question. It's really one for our Treasury officials to look at. The government, as you realise, collects all its tax revenues together and juggles it, how it collects it and then how it pays out. So it's not just done per department.
Okay. Lee, do you have a view on that?
I saw on the news yesterday that they're looking at changes in road tax. I mean, I'm not sure whether that's a way that they're considering to perhaps recoup some of the losses, like you mentioned, Jeremy, on the reduction in tax paid on fossil fuels. Is that fair to say, Darren? Is that something that the government are looking at the moment?
Press reports, because I haven't read them and haven't got lines on them. Within OLEV, we have stated what we're doing in terms of incentives and looking at that. And as I said, vehicle excise duty continuing and how we're doing that. I think if you look at parallel things like health and smoking, any reduction in
tax from cigarettes isn't regained by taxing somebody else who has health. It's done elsewhere in the economy. So I don't think people should be necessarily hung up on recouping money lost from the same cadre of people. It's, as I said, it's the UK economy is where the tax is got from.
Okay, understood. Should the banning of the sale of internal combustion vehicles be applied at the same time for cars and vans, or should the ban apply to new cars first and then vans, say, 5 years later?
So I think this is all within the consultation, which again hasn't been published. So within the consultation, the question is the end of the sale of new vehicles, not banning them per se. So I think, again, just need to reiterate that, but I can't preempt what will be the conclusions of it before it's published, unfortunately.
Okay, thank you. One more, how will you ensure interoperability across charge point networks to give maximum access to drivers?
So that's kind of my last slide of, again, we have a consultation looking at exactly this. We recognise it's an issue. We recognise that reliability is an issue. So we are actually going out there asking what could be done, what should be done. And from that, we will formulate our policy position and then any action on the back of it.
Lee, do you have an opinion on that?
The one thing, you know, I think we've had discussions about is particularly with charge points. I think it'd be useful if you have the ability to pre-book them. I'm not sure whether that's anything that that OLEV are looking at or any other sort of vehicle agency. Is that under consideration, Darren? Is that in the consultation? Is that feasible, do you think?
I honestly don't know. It's an interesting idea for sure.
I just think there's obviously the inoperability issue, but I also think the anxiety attached to electric vehicles is still very strong, and you know, we still see a lot of it. I've had conversations with a few people about it, and I just thought, well, whilst I had the opportunity, I thought I'd mention it, really.
Yeah, I'll definitely get into the consultation so it gets into the mix.
Good.
Another question submitted by one of the audience members. How will the charge points, the number of charge points in 2035 compare to that of petrol stations in existence today?
I think it'd be quite a different world. The ways that you can charge your vehicle are hugely different from the ways you can fill up a petrol or diesel car. So a lot of people will be doing it at home. Some people would be doing it at work. You've got the on-street, and then you've got all the rapid hubs dotted around and the fast-charging hubs. You might be doing it at your destination if you're going shopping or if you're going to stay in a hotel. So there will be a myriad of options. So there'll be a huge amount more charge points than there are petrol stations, just because you have that range of options and you need that range of options.
And Well, one of the kind of anxieties around charging is not only the number and locality of charging points, but will I be able to use the one that is nearest to me? So what can you ensure about the interoperability of charge points across a national network to tackle that second anxiety, if you like?
In the consumer experience consultation, we are looking at the information provided and reliability. So people need to be able to plan, basically, if they're going for longer journeys. If they're going for short journeys, they will have an awareness of where they can charge around their a property. If they're buying it, they want to research it. So it's making sure that they're informed and that information is accurate.
Yeah, sure. Lee, do you sort of concur with that? aspiration.
Absolutely. You know, I think, you know, as a nation, we're getting more and more familiar with this now. And, we're seeing, you know, the increased uptake on electric vehicles. And I think, you know, I liken it, it's a bit of an analogy to the iPhone. You know, who thought sort of 20 years ago that we would, you know, be so reliant on our phones as we are now. And I sort of think, you know, with electronification of vehicles, I think in probably 10 years time, I think we'll be staggered by just how much of a normality it is that, you know, you buy a house, you look at the charging infrastructure around you, you go on holiday, you plan your journey, you use these app maps or whatever. And I think it will become a way of life. I think it will be, I can see that's where it's heading.
Excellent, thank you. So grants. Fundamental to fleet cost calculation. So how long will the current grants continue, and what notice will we get from the government when they decide to end them?
So as I alluded to, we've got spending review going on, which is where the government sets out its expenditure for the next 4 years, or if it's a rollover spending review, 1 year, which constrains really how long we can say we will support the grants for, unless, like Project Rapid, we've already committed to extending it for a number of years. So we would like to continue them for as long as they're needed and they provide that value for money. Again, there will become a point where we get towards price parity and there's no longer a good use of the taxpayers' money. There might be other things which are better. So there's always that thing to weigh up. But at the minute, the grants are there. In the short term, they probably will continue to be needed.
Lee, do you think there's an optimum notice period for the industry to be prepared should grants come to an end?
Yes, absolutely. On the spot, I don't know what that is. I think, you know, at the moment they've committed to 5 years benefit in kind tax, and I think that gives you know, both drivers and fleet managers that sort of foresight and time to plan, and I think that's a good amount of time personally. I think 5 years probably would be a sensible amount of time.
Okay. I think we've got time for maybe one or two more. What prospect, what's the likelihood is there of offering a grant to the buyers of used EVs to support residual values?
I think it's lower, to be honest, just because it's already received, that vehicle's already received one grant in it. And it's kind of harder to manage that secondhand transfer, especially person-to-person transfer. So I think the practicalities of it and the philosophy behind it make it hard to support.
Lee, do you have an opinion?
I think, you know, residual values are still a bit of an unknown. One thing we've talked about is the uncertainty or perhaps anxiety attached to buying a used vehicle with a, you know, a battery in it that's worth, you know, £10,000 or whatever. So for me, I agree with Darren. I think, you know, to subsidise it and provide grants would be very complicated and probably quite hard to manage. But I think that the infrastructure and the support around used electric vehicles, particularly when they're sort of approaching the end of their warranty, needs addressing at some point, probably, you know, by the motor sector rather than OLEV.
Okay.
And I think we'll probably see, you know, organisations, you know, starting up businesses and whatever to recondition and support, you know, used cars.
Sure. Well, thank you both. That seemed to fly by. A fantastic response from our audience. Some very interesting questions there. Now, I do have to wrap up with one note, and that is the presentations are going to be available for a full 28 days after the event finishes. So if you feel you missed anything or want to recap, then please head back to the website at any point within that 28-day period. So thank you very much, Dr. Darren Handley and Lee Brown. All the best to everyone here and to you and to those that attend. Thank you very much.